السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. In the name of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, most gracious, most merciful. Alhamdulillah rabbil alameen. All praise is indeed due to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, creator, nourisher, cherisher, sustainer, provider, protector, curer, the one who is in absolute control of every single aspect of existence. We praise him. We praise him in a way that pleases him, and we praise him in a way that will grant us the ultimate success. We send blessings and salutations upon Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, the one who is the best of creation, chosen by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to come to us in order to teach us, to guide us, to show us the straight path, to show us how we would be able to lead a life wherein we would be successful in this world as well as the next. That is Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. It is wrong for us not to send blessings and salutations upon he who brought us all the goodness from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Blessings and salutations upon his entire family, those who stood by him and supported him from the first day. Blessings and salutations upon his companions, those who fought with him for justice to reclaim the land that was usurped from them. May blessings and salutations be upon all those who have struggled, strove through the centuries in a way that today we are seated here with the blessing known as Iman. We have belief. That's what distinguishes us from the others. We believe that we are on this globe for a purpose. We believe that we were created for a reason. And this is a believer. We believe that when we die, everything is not just over. That is the beginning of the eternal life. So we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to grant us and our offspring goodness. May Allah bless every single one of us. Ameen. Brothers and sisters, if I were to ask you, what is the ultimate success? What do you think is the ultimate success? A lot of people, if they were caught off guard, if they were perhaps not at this particular convention where they know what we're talking about, they would say, well, I would like to earn X amount. They would say, I would like to achieve, for example, a certain item in my life, either a position or an amount of wealth, or for example, a number of children, sometimes even a number of wives. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us success. To be honest, that is only a small portion of what people may perceive as success in this temporary life, the duration of which you have no clue. None of us has an idea when we would drop. And this is why, in order to puncture that balloon for every one of us who aims so high in the world without thinking about aiming for the hereafter, Allah makes it very, very clear. كُلُّ نَفْسٍ ذَائِقَةُ الْمَوْتِ. Every single soul shall taste death. Allah didn't say you will go through death. Allah didn't say you will pass by death. Allah did not say you will receive death. He said you will taste death, because death has a taste. It is sweet for those who prepared for it, and it is sour for those who forgot it. Those who prepared for it automatically, when they decrease the ill and the evil that they may have been engaged in, and when they constantly repented to the Almighty on a daily basis, the day they will die, they would have already started the day in a way that they are used to, with the seeking of forgiveness of Allah, the praising of Allah, the recitation of the Quran. The angels would have written, this is the day upon which this person has died, and he started the day by the recitation of the Quran. Hence, please start every single day with blessed words. Start the day with praise of Allah. Start the day seeking forgiveness of Allah. Because there will be a day when you will die. And guess what? If you made that a habit, it will be a blessed day. Allahumma ij'al khayra ayyamina awakhiraha. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam used to say, oh Allah, make the best of our days the last days. Make the best of my days the last days. وَخَيْرَ أَعْمَالِنَا خَوَاتِيمَهَا. And make the best of my deeds the last deeds I'm going to do. Imagine a person happened to protect himself from adultery, from gambling, from the shirk, from various other sins. from participating in fortune telling, perhaps in magic and going to the magicians and so on. A person protected himself for 70 years. And right at the end, he started doing all these things. It would be foolish. On the other hand, you have another who is trying every day, improving. Like I said in one of the previous lectures here at this beautiful convention of the Straight Path, that even if you are moving a millimeter at a time, the point is you are moving forward. Even if you are moving an inch at a time, the point is you are moving forward. Brothers and sisters, let's make it such that we are moving forward, not backward. Aim in the correct direction. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala help us. This is why it is very important for us to be focused. Let's take a look at the next part of the same verse or the following verse. Allah says, وَإِنَّمَا تُوَفَّوْنَ أُجُورَكُمْ يَوْمَ الْقِيَامَةِ. And indeed, you will only receive your full recompense of your deeds on the Day of Judgment. In this world, Allah will grant you a compensation. If you are good, He will give you goodness. But goodness of this world is not according to my understanding and yours. It is more to do with contentment within the heart. When you do good and you engage in istighfar, you start your day in a way that pleases Allah. When you read your salah or fulfill it, you fulfill it as though that is the last opportunity you're going to get to fulfill salah. The Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says clearly, salli salata muwaddai. Whenever you fulfill your prayer, fulfill it in a way that you believe this is my last opportunity with Allah. You will always do it in a proper fashion. You will always do it in the best way. Imagine if a person was to put a gun at your head and if a person was to tell you that I give you one wish, what would you say? Let me phone my mother, let me call my dad, let me do this, let me quickly speak to my son. No, a believer would say, let me engage in prayer for Allah. Am I not right? We all believe that. But my brothers and sisters, what is held at our heads is far more dangerous than a person holding a gun, because a person holding a gun, you see them, you know them. Malakul Maut, the angel of death, you don't see, you don't know. He comes to you suddenly and he takes you away. This is why if you have read all your prayers in a way that this was the last prayer, perhaps there will come a day when that will definitely be your last prayer. You would have succeeded. May Allah take us away in the condition of sujood. Say Ameen. Now that we've said Ameen, I ask you, do we even fulfill salah for that to become a possibility? If you want to die in sujood, well, start making that sujood. What's the point of a person saying, oh Allah, take me in sujood, but you don't read your prayers. You don't fulfill anything for the sake of Allah. Oh Allah, take me away while I'm reading Quran, but you never open the Quran. I once asked a young boy regarding this, and I said, wouldn't it be an honor to die in sujood? He says, yes. I said, well, why don't you read your salah? He says, because I don't want to die. People have cash answers. They know I'm making dua, oh Allah, take me in sujood. But because I'm not in sujood, I think to myself, well, that means I'm not going to go yet. Come on, don't be a fool. This is why the Quran says, your proper recompense you will only receive on the Day of Judgment. Because in this world, we will go through trials. We will go through tribulations. That is not a sign of the anger of Allah. When do I know that it's a punishment from Allah? When the condition of my heart is wrong. When my link with Allah is not there. When I'm not trying to develop a link with my own maker, then I know what has come in my direction is a punishment. Why? Because I've got no link with He who created me. But if I'm trying, if I'm trying my best to please Allah, I'm trying to eradicate my bad habits, I always turn to Allah, I seek forgiveness from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, I'm a person who prays and I try to learn more of the Quran so that my prayer is not only consisting of قُلْ هُوَ اللَّهُ أَحَدْ and إِنَّا أَعْطَيْنَاكَ الْكَوْثَرَ. You and I know that when we start prayer, a lot of the times we fulfill it as a duty. Start fulfilling it as an honor and see the difference. When we fulfill the 5 daily prayers, a lot of us, we want to get over and done with it. Where is he or she who is considering it an honor? You arrive in the masjid a little bit earlier. You take your time to read a little bit of the voluntary prayer. The sunnah is what depicts and determines who exactly you are in terms of your link with Allah. I have the time to offer much more than what's just an obligation to me. If a person you love most tells you, you have 5 minutes with me, sit and talk, let's see. You would want to extend the time. Why? Because you love them a lot. In 5 minutes, I'm not going to manage to say what I want. So in that particular case, you would ask for more time. If they said, I give you more time, it would be an honor. And if you just took more time and they didn't mind at all, what would happen? Why is it with our most beloved being the creator himself? Thereafter, Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, we find ourselves not fulfilling enough when it comes to the type of salah, the duration of the prayer, the amount of time we spend reading the life of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Trust me, if you have a problem in your life, begin to read the autobiography of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam in depth, in detail. You will find that the challenges he went through are far greater than anything you would ever go through. Yet he was patient. Yet he was determined. Why? Because he was focused upon the ultimate success, the goal. He was always focused. He knew, I'm going to try my best, but Allah is in charge. Allah is in control. There is a limited amount I can do. The rest is in the hands of Allah. A driver driving a vehicle can drive that car to the best of their ability. They can be known as the best driver. But whether exactly they are going to get to the destination or not is in the hands of Allah. You tried your best. Leave the rest in the hands of Allah. Be happy with what Allah has chosen for you. Yes, there will be challenges and you will face a lot of obstacles. Some of them major obstacles. For as long as those obstacles are not made by yourself, you should thank Allah. If they were made by yourself, you need to be worried. Turn to Allah in repentance. You see the board behind me, some of the major obstacles made mention of during this particular convention. And ask yourselves, do I, or am I guilty of participating in any one of them? And do I participate in any one of them right now? If the case is that the answer is yes, tell yourself here and now, I stop now. I cut it for the sake of Allah. Whenever you hear a moving word that is drawn from revelation in order to reach out to you to become closer to Allah, never fall in the trap of the devil who will come to tell you, okay, Ramadan is only 3 months down. Inshallah, from Ramadan, I'm going to change my life. You don't know if you're going to see Ramadan. Have an intention in your heart. Oh Allah, right now, I'm changing. Right now, I will inch forward. Right now, I will quit my bad habit. Today, it's over. Each one of us knows what our bad habits are. Some of them are serious. Some of them may be considered less serious. But the point is, we can all do better when it comes to these habits. Change them. This is how you will achieve ultimate success. Without changing a bad habit, only saying I'm going to change, you will also perhaps be dreaming about the goal, but you're not going to get there. A person who says, I want to go for Hajj, I want to go for Umrah, they don't want to save the money, they don't want to apply for a visa, they don't want to do anything, make any effort. What do they think? Do they think suddenly a genie is going to appear and say, your dua is accepted, let's go for Umrah. Ooh, you start flying in the air. That's not going to happen. Make an effort. Do something about it. Start saving the money. Apply for a visa. Find out how it's done. Go and book accommodation. Ask people. Cleanse your heart, because those whose hearts are not clean are not deserving of the mercy of Allah. If you want the mercy of Allah, clean your heart a little bit. When you start, Allah says, you come to me a handspan, I will come to you a whole foot. I spoke about that earlier. And I'm repeating it to say, if you come to Allah slowly, He comes to you quickly. If you come to Allah walking, He comes to you rushing. But you have to come to Allah. You can't be turning away from Allah and then expect Allah to come to you. Still, through Allah's mercy, He gives us a lot. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala makes it quite clear that in this world, you will get a lot, but you may not get what you want. Because this world is not all about getting what you want. For that, we have kept a certain place known as Jannah, paradise. We always say paradise would lose its value if you had to have everything you wished for in this world. Because then you would get to the hereafter and say, well, I already had a life where I got everything I wished for. What's the point of having this life? Therefore, part of the plan of Allah is none of us, no exception to this, will ever get every single thing we just wish for. No, there has to be restriction in order for us to appreciate Jannah. The day Allah says, فِيهَا مَا تَشْتَهِي الْأَنفُسُ وَتَلَذُّ الْأَعْيُنُ. In it, there is everything that the soul shall desire. Everything the soul desires, you will achieve, you will have, it will be yours, you will get it on condition that you desire that while you are in paradise. From now, These minds of ours may not even know what is there. The hadith says, فيها ما لا عين رأت ولا أذن سمعت ولا خطر على قلب بشر. In Jannah, there are things that no eye has ever seen. So if you've seen something, trust me, it's not there. You know, every time the women get excited, I'm happy. My husband's not going to be there. We don't mean that. He will be there, but with an absolutely perfect character, perfect mind, perfect body, according to your taste. Now do you want him? Some women will still say no. That's how much we've harassed them, my beloved brothers. And I think vice versa as well. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala save us. Oh, the men are saying ameen. Allahu Akbar. Allahu Akbar. But the ultimate goal is such that, my brothers and sisters, when you arrive there, you won't regret having worked hard for it. But when you see others going in and you are not from among them, there will be regret. May Allah forgive us. May Allah take us to Jannah through His mercy, because our deeds, sometimes we know and we feel that the sincerity levels or the manner in which we've done our deeds or the amount of deeds, if it's not for the mercy of Allah, we're still not going to go to Jannah. We are weak. So the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam says, in Jannah is that which no eye has ever seen, no ears have ever heard of, or no ears have ever heard. So if you've heard something or heard of something, trust me, what is in paradise is something far better. And in it is that which it has not crossed the mind. It has not even crossed the heart of a human. So if in your imagination, something has crossed your imagination, your mind, your heart, trust me, in Jannah is better than that. You have no clue what is being prepared or has been prepared, in fact, there. But we need to work towards it. To work towards that ultimate success, I need to endure. I need to have sabr. Sabr to do what? Sabr to be able to fulfill my obligations unto Allah in a way that He wants them to be fulfilled, not according to my whims and fancies. You cannot read Salatul Fajr at the time of Asr every day and tell yourself, well, you know what? I think it's a better time. You don't choose it. Allah chooses it. You cannot say, I want to read X amount of units or raka'at of prayer for Salatul Dhuhr, which is more than four or less than four. You cannot say that, because it's Allah who chooses how, what, and how much you will read. So endurance. You need endurance. You need patience. You also need patience to restrain yourself. The term sabr includes restraining from what? From that which will earn the wrath of Allah. That which will be an obstacle in your path. On the straight path, yes, shaitan is sitting around. He is calling people towards all these paths on the side. This is why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam to instruct the believers, وَأَنَّ هَذَا صِرَاطِي مُسْتَقِيمًا فَاتَّبِعُوهُ. Indeed, this is my path, the straight path, so follow it. وَلَا تَتَّبِعُوا السُّبُلَ فَتَفَرَّقَ بِكُمْ عَن سَبِيلِهِ. And do not follow the paths on the side. There is a devil on each one of those paths calling towards that path, because then it will distract you from this one beautiful path of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So therefore, there is recognition of the fact that the devil exists. There is recognition of the fact that evil exists. But a believer will continue to protect himself. You know, if you have the GPS today, mashallah, it's made life so easy. I use it so often and I ask myself, I have actually forgotten how life was before the GPS. And if you intentionally or unintentionally choose a wrong path, you know what the lady says? Why are we smiling? It's not just the women who lead you down the wrong path. No. Let's say what the man says. It depends on your settings, my brothers and sisters. Don't get me wrong. No offense. So what the man says, he says, make a U-turn when possible. Have you heard that? Wallahi, there are angels telling you, make a U-turn when possible. Every time you sin against Allah and you feel it initially, but if you continue on that path, what does it say? Rerouting, recalculating, and so on. May Allah forgive us. Then we go via a long, you know, way. We want to go to Penang and we end up in Ipoh. That's what happens. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala forgive us. Why? You continued on the path, wrong path. The same happens. If you want to choose that path, you will go to Jannah because you're a believer, but you might go via Jahannam. Yes, and you don't want that to happen. I'd rather a direct flight to say, wow, we're landing and here we are at my destination. Imagine if you were to land straight into Medina Munawwara, better than a person who goes from here to China, from China to India, from India somewhere else, and you say, I got a very cheap ticket. A cheap ticket, but you struggled and you suffered. Imagine if Allah gave you the amount of sustenance to be able to buy that ticket. With comfort, you flew straight into the destination you wanted to. May Allah grant us that on the Day of Judgment. Ameen. So this is the ultimate success. And this is why we say you will get what you want on that day, not in this world. Many people, when you ask them about success, they begin to rattle things that are all worldly. A true believer may consider some of that point of success indeed. But ultimately, do you know what Allah says? And these are the verses that I've chosen to read this evening because they are apt to the topic that we do have. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says,
فَمَنْ زُحْزِحَ عَنِ النَّارِ وَأُدْخِلَ الْجَنَّةَ فَقَدْ فَازَ.
Whoever is kept away from hellfire, whoever is protected from hellfire, whoever is saved from hellfire, and is granted entry into Jannah, into paradise, is the one who has achieved ultimate success. May Allah grant it to us. So Allah starts off by saying, every soul shall taste death. Now death, for you and me, sometimes we look at it and we are scared, we're worried. When am I going to die? What's going to happen to my children? What's going to happen to this that I'm going to leave behind? I'm still young. The most important worry is not supposed to be what's going to happen to what I'm going to leave behind, because you will always leave behind something. And there are others younger and stronger than you who left behind more than you. Sometimes their lives are happier without the person. May Allah forgive us. This is why we say, O son of Adam, when you came onto the earth, you came crying while those around you were smiling. Weren't they smiling? And when you came to this world, you were crying. When you came to this world, you were crying. Little baby, mashallah. So live your life in such a way that when you leave this world, you leave smiling and those around you are crying. The opposite. When you came, it was the other way around. You were crying, they were smiling. But you led your life in such a beautiful way that when you left with a smile. And those around you were crying at the loss. You left a legacy. You left something for mankind to benefit from. And you took it from the sunnah of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam. Many of us think that if I teach my child salah, and I teach them hijab, and I teach them Quran, and I teach them this, that's enough. You have to teach them from that Quran, character, conduct, how to reach out to others, to be able to fulfill the rights of human beings, to reach out to people who belong to different faiths, with your character and conduct, and at times even with a beautiful discussion, to be able to be promoter of peace, harmony, tolerance. All this is part of the deen. Go and study the life of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam. And you will come across amazing incidents. Right at the end when he passed away, he had his armor that was given as collateral to a Jewish man because he had food from that Jewish man when visitors had visited him. Did you know that? And people say, don't deal with the Jews. It's got to do with what Allah says. Yes, you may choose not to deal with certain people if there is a situation that requires that. Indeed. Sometimes they may even be people who are Muslim, calling themselves Muslim, but perpetrating heinous crimes against humanity in the name of a faith that does not preach that. What will you do? You have to cut off. You have to make it clear. That's how you will achieve ultimate success. You cannot just go to paradise when you see evil and you've done nothing meaningful about it. But do not combat evil with evil. Do not combat evil with that which will result in greater evil, because you are foolish. Many people, when they have a problem, even in the home or in the business or anywhere else, they deal with it in a way that creates 10 problems out of one. I'd rather live as a believer with one problem than to add another 9 because of the way I dealt with it. That's how you achieve ultimate success. You are concerned. لا يؤمن أحدكم حتى يحب لأخيه ما يحب لنفسه. None of you are true believers until you love for your fellow human beings, for your brother, what you love for yourself. What do I love for myself? MashaAllah. Alhamdulillah. You know, it reminds me of an incident where they say that there was a man who was told that you will have whatever you ask for. And your friend, sorry, your enemy, the person you don't like, will be given double of what you ask. And this man was thinking, well, look, I've got an opportunity. If I say no, I don't want, because I'm going to be jealous of what my friend gets, I'm going to lose out. So he says, I'm caught in a situation. Let me just start asking for things, see what happens. He says, I want a mansion. I want a huge mansion. I wanted a huge mansion filled with the latest of everything. And suddenly it was there. And as he looked across the road, he saw his enemy with a double-sized mansion in front of him. You got what you wanted. What's the point? Why worry about what someone else has got? You become depressed, not because you don't have enough, because you are looking at what others have got, but you have enough. So then he says, okay, I want a mountain of gold, and he gets it. And his friend gets two mountains of gold, and he's saying, ah, come on. Look at the dirty heart. So then he says, okay, you're going to give my enemy, it's the enemy actually, double. Yes. Okay, I want you to scare me half to death. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala forgive us. You can imagine what happened to that enemy of his. That's how bad man is. But in Islam, when we say that we love for others what we love for ourselves, we really mean it. We will pray for them. We will ask Allah to bless them, to grant them contentment. Remember, happiness does not come with figures. Happiness comes with contentment. Be content with what Allah has bestowed upon you. That does not mean don't work for more. No. Within the limits that Allah has allowed, you will work for more. It's not bad to have a lot of wealth. But to allow that to mess your attitude and character is what is bad. The best of people are those who have authority and wealth, and they are more humble than those who don't have authority or wealth. Those are the best. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us strength. That's how you achieve ultimate success. You will enter paradise with those whom you have assisted in a good cause. You and I know that the Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, taught us that when there is goodness that you are involved in, don't be selfish with it. Share it with others. Teach people. You will be rewarded for everyone who follows your good example. But if you're a person who set a bad example, where do you expect to go? The gatekeepers of hell, it is in the Quran that they will ask the people who will be entering hell, hey, أَلَمْ يَأْتِكُمْ رُسُلٌ مِّنْكُمْ يَتْلُونَ عَلَيْكُمْ آيَاتِ رَبِّكُمْ وَيُنذِرُونَكُمْ لِقَاءَ يَوْمِكُمْ هَذَا. Did messengers not come to you reciting the verses of Allah, reminding you about this day, that there will be a day of resurrection when there will be accounts of all your deeds? Didn't anyone come to remind you reading the verses? And you know what? The response will be, Bala, yes indeed they came. But what happened? Oh, we lost out. We didn't believe them. We didn't take them seriously. Let's not be from among those. Surely we would like the gatekeepers of Jannah having the doors of Jannah open for us. And they say, أُدْخُلُوهَا بِسَلَامٍ آمِنِينَ. Enter with all peace and security. You are so secure, no fear, nothing. You enter. This paradise belongs to you. May Allah grant that to us. Ameen. The gatekeepers of Jannah. Do you know what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says? Let's listen to these beautiful verses. Surah Az-Zumar.
وَسِيقَ الَّذِينَ اتَّقَوْا رَبَّهُمْ إِلَى الْجَنَّةِ زُمَرًا.
The people who used to be conscious of Allah during their short period of life in this world, on that day, they will be driven into paradise in groups.
حَتَّى إِذَا جَاءُوهَا وَفُتِحَتْ أَبْوَابُهَا.
When they get to Jannah, they will find the doors wide open. Unlike hell, the doors are closed. When you get there, then they open the doors. There is a difference of a wow. Wow is one of the letters of the Arabic alphabet. If Allah says, Futihat abwaabuha, it means you get there and then the doors are open. And if Allah says, Wa futihat abwaabuha, it means when you get there, the doors will already be opened. Amazing the difference one little letter can make in meaning. So when you want to enter as a VIP into a place, as you are walking in, you sail straight through, you don't stand and knock on the door. They know you're coming. The door is open and you're welcome. But when you're going into a prison, they don't open the door. They wait for you to come. You stand at the door. Then the door opens. As you go in, it closes again. You cannot go out. Allahu Akbar. That's the description Allah has delivered just by a single wow in the Quran. So when they are going into paradise, and I'm sure inshallah we will be from among them, I have hope and I want you to have the same hope. And the angels will say to us, mashallah.
وَقَالَ لَهُمْ خَزَنَتُهَا سَلَامٌ عَلَيْكُمْ طِبْتُمْ فَادْخُلُوهَا خَالِدِينَ
The gatekeepers of paradise will say, سَلَامٌ عَلَيْكُمْ You know what that means? Peace be upon you. You have done good. So now you can enter into this Jannah forever and ever. Subhanallah. Wouldn't we love that? Well, in that particular case, my brothers and sisters, abstain from sin. Fulfill your obligations unto Allah. We've heard in the last convention, the obligations we have unto Allah. How to earn Jannah. We heard about it. Today, or in this convention, the last 2 days, we've been hearing about the obstacles, those things we need to abstain from in order that the entry into paradise is made smooth. So take heed. And inshallah, you will be able to enter Jannah in such a beautiful way. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has described it in so many different places. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells us that is the ultimate success. When a person is saved from hellfire, we are saved from hellfire because we saved ourselves from deeds that will displease Allah. And guess what? The biggest gift we have is something known as tawbah. Repentance. It's a huge gift. Imagine if we committed a sin and we had no way out. Even shirk is forgiven on condition that you seek that forgiveness while you're alive. The Sahaba radiallahu anhum, companions of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, majority of them were mushrikeen before they accepted Islam. They used to worship idols, sticks, stones, dates. You know, a little pile of dates made in the form of an idol. But what happened? When they declared their faith and they changed their lives, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala blessed them in such a powerful name that in such a powerful way that today when we hear their name, every one of us will say radiyallahu anhu, at least in our minds. If I were to just say Abu Bakr, Umar, Uthman, Ali, that's blasphemous. In fact, it's disrespectful. It's disrespectful. If I were to say any one of those names, I need to say Abu Bakr, radiyallahu anhu. Umar, radiyallahu anhu. Aisha, radiyallahu anha. Hafsa, radiyallahu anha. If I don't say that, I am denying the favors of Allah upon me. Allah chose a group of people. He only chose the best. Why would Allah choose companions of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, him being the best of creation, and then for the best of creation, Allah chooses those who are not good? That wouldn't be the case. Allah chose the best of the lot. We do not doubt that. They are the carriers and torchbearers of the entire faith. If we were to disrespect them, we would lose entire faith. It would be replaced with some other faith, and we wouldn't even know that the faith has been snatched away from us. This is why, my brothers and sisters, it's important to respect those who have taught you any goodness, no matter what. I remember the teachers that I have had from grade one, from kindergarten, all the way coming up to the end of secondary school, going into university. And do you know what? When I get an opportunity, I try my best to be in touch with them. I have teachers who've taught me mathematics who were Christian. I have teachers who taught me when I was as young as grade four. One of the ladies is actually alive. Without a lie, I met her a few days before I came here. And she's very old. Why did I meet her? She taught me some goodness. That's why. She's not a Muslim. That's besides the point. I took the goodness. I didn't take the deen. I know what to take. But because of that, I respect this lady. And I believe that by me maintaining a positive relationship with such an elderly woman who did good to me at this stage in my life and that stage in her life, it would have such a positive impact. Who knows? Perhaps Allah can guide her through a good deed. And guidance is not in my hands, but my duty is to make the effort. The problem with us, we don't make an effort. As she taught me, but she's a non-Muslim, why should I go? Go. All the more reason to go. The hadith says, وَاللَّهِ لَأَنْ يَهْدِيَ اللَّهُ بِكَ رَجُلًا وَاحِدًا خَيْرٌ لَكَ مِنْ حُمُرِ النَّعَمِ. You want ultimate success? Wallahi, for you, for Allah to use you to guide one person is better for you than everything or than the most valuable of material items on this earth. The term used is حُمُرِ النَّعَمِ, which means the red camel. You know, today, maybe the S-Class Mercedes, for example, equivalent to the red camel of the time. Possible. Imagine someone were to say, you guide one person, we give you S-Class. Some of us would be having a whole garage of S-Classes. May Allah help us. So reach out to people. These are not yet Muslim. Up to the point of your death and their death, you have to have hope. You don't just go out and eradicate them. These are non-Muslims, I need to kill them off. No, that is warped thinking. That is un-Islamic thinking. That is actually a means of eradicating mankind at large and insulting the same deen that the blessed Prophet has brought, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. How would you achieve success? One of the ways is to reach out to people. So if you were a person who actually harmed others, what success do you expect? Can you really expect success when you were selfish? You only cared for yourself. You harmed people. You taught others how to harm the rest of the world just because you disagree with them. Think of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Look at how he treated his people. Look at how he treated those who harmed him. He had hope. What happened as a result? Communities followed him. Nations followed him. He did not come to this part of the world, but his message came immediately to this part of the world. Through what? History shows us that it's not necessarily through those who came with the only intention of propagation. That may have been one of their intentions, but a lot of them were business people who were upright in business. They dealt in such an honest way that resulted in their success in the business, number one, and thereafter in the akhirah, in the hereafter. Because the continent changed, everything changed. Who would have known at that time that there will come a time when the Muslim population will be projected at 2.5 billion people? It started off with one man. He ran down the cave, telling his wife, Zammiluni, Zammiluni, cover me, cover me. That covering, subhanAllah, a result of that embrace being released. Look at what happened across the globe. SubhanAllah, success. You have the help of Allah. You have the help of those whom Allah has placed right near you. Appreciate that. Allah lets you meet people on earth for a purpose. Some of them are there to test you. Some of them are there to help you. Remember this. Some of them are there to check you, to test you, to see your worth. And some of them are there to help you in goodness, and others will be there to try and lure you into that which is filled with destruction. Don't follow that path. It will be made clear to you if you have faith and you have knowledge. But without faith and knowledge, what do we expect, my brothers and sisters? Knowledge without faith is a waste. And faith without knowledge is ignorance, which is doubled. Those perpetrating crimes against humanity today, in the name of Islam, they claim they have faith, they believe, but they don't have knowledge, or their knowledge is warped. And then you have, on the other hand, those who have lots of knowledge. They don't even believe in God anymore. We are in the middle. We believe in Allah. We believe in the hereafter. We know we are aiming for something high. Man is so important, much more important than the one who says when you die, you are over. We are much more important than that. I am alive. I'm speaking to you. You feel me. You can hear me. You understand what I'm saying. It has an impact on myself and yourselves. Do you really think a day will come when it's over? Nothing else is left. In fact, a day will come when I will swim into the hereafter. I do not believe that I'm so insignificant that a day will come when I die without being resurrected. No one will ever speak about me again, and I won't be known, and nothing will happen, and that's the end of everything. I will go back into nature and I will be reincarnated or whatever else. Those who want to believe that have the right to believe that. They have the answer to be given to Allah, not to me. Remember that. But I need to ask about myself. Where am I standing today? What am I doing today? A lot of us here, we know that we want to change, but we're just saying, okay, tomorrow, okay, the next day. Don't do that. Say, here and now, oh Allah, I turn towards you and I walk towards you, oh Allah. Help me on that path. And start off one by one. And you will feel good, because part of that success is that you feel good in this world. Listen to what Allah says.
Ya ayyuhal ladhina amanu hal adullukum ala tijaratin tunjikum min adhabin aleem.
O you who believe, should I not show you a transaction, a business deal that will save you from a painful punishment? Who wants to be cast into a painful punishment? No one. Should I show you that transaction or business deal that will save you from a painful punishment? Why does Allah call it a transaction? One of the reasons is because on that day Allah says, subhanahu wa ta'ala,
إِنَّ الَّذِينَ ظَلَمُوا لَوْ أَنَّ لَهُمْ مَا فِي الْأَرْضِ جَمِيعًا وَمِثْلَهُ مَعَهُ لِيَفْتَدُوا بِهِ مَا تُقُبِّلَ مِنْهُمْ.
Allah says, those who've oppressed themselves, on that day, if they had wealth or if they had material possession, the size of the whole world or double that, in order to give it as a ransom to free them from the fire, it won't be accepted.
يَوْمَ لَا يَنْفَعُ مَالٌ وَلَا بَنُونَ إِلَّا مَنْ أَتَى اللَّهَ بِقَلْبٍ سَلِيمٍ.
On that day, that your wealth and your children will not help you besides the one who comes with a clean, pure heart, free of sickness. It's your heart. So what is this business that Allah is speaking about?
تؤمنون بالله ورسوله.
You believe in Allah and believe in the Messenger. Believe in Allah, believe in the Messenger.
وتجاهدون في سبيل الله بأموالكم وأنفسكم.
And strive in the pleasure of Allah, in the cause of Allah. Strive to become a better person. Strive for all good things. Strive to protect yourself and others from all bad things. Strive to earn that paradise. That is the strive. When Allah speaks of the struggle and the striving, that struggle and striving is so broad, it encompasses every day of yours. My day is a struggle. I strive every day, and I call upon you to strive, and to strive more and more on a daily basis. To do what? To earn the pleasure of Allah. Some of us want to solve the problems of the whole globe, but we haven't solved our own matters. We want to solve the problem of this country and that nation, and we want to be bothered about here and there, and we make a big noise about that state and this one here, but we haven't solved our own condition. We don't even read salah. We don't have a link with Allah. We don't even know if we will achieve the success. May Allah guide us. May He help us. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala open our doors. Then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, after He makes mention of these three things, one is believe in Allah, believe in the Messenger, and strive and struggle with your wealth and with yourself. Your wealth meaning Allah gave you the wealth, and He's telling you, look, spend, don't become miserly.
أنفق يا ابن آدم ينفق عليك.
Spend, O son of Adam, it will be spent upon you. Which means when you spend, Allah will grant you barakah. Allah will grant you more. Nobody has ever become poor because of a charity he or she has been giving. Then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says,
ذَلِكُمْ خَيْرٌ لَكُمْ إِن كُنتُمْ تَعْلَمُونَ.
That is better for you if only but you know. If you know, then that is better for you. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says thereafter, He makes mention of
Jannah. He makes mention of paradise. And he says, we will grant you paradise beneath which rivers are flowing. And then he says, that is the ultimate success. I'm sure you've heard the verses. ذَلِكَ الْفَوْزُ الْعَظِيمُ وَذَلِكَ هُوَ الْفَوْزُ الْمُبِينُ. And so many different verses making mention of al-fawz. Al-fawz meaning the success. Every one of them is speaking more of the hereafter than it is of this world. That is the ultimate success. That is the believer. So we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to open our doors. Brothers and sisters, we have heard a lot. Let's not be from among those who just hears and appreciates, wow, good talk, powerful message, but it hasn't moved us at all. What's the point of that? Let us change our lives. Because I tell you, from the story of the Prophet Noah, may peace be upon him, Nuh alayhi salatu wasalam, we learn something powerful and scary. What is it? There came a stage when Nuh alayhi salam was calling his people for centuries. 950 years he spent calling his people towards goodness, one after the other. It is reported that a small number of people accepted his message, perhaps between 11 and 80, according to the minimum and the maximum mentioned in the various narrations. Between 11 and 80, even if we take the biggest figure, which is 80. 950 years, only 80 people, less than 10 every 100 years. Less than 10 every 100 years. Then what happened? He made a dua, he made a supplication, saying, oh Allah, these people are harassing me, they are troubling me, oh Allah, they are not accepting the faith. Oh Allah, I want some form of closure here. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, لَن يُؤْمِنَ مِن قَوْمِكَ إِلَّا مَن قَدْ آمَنَ. Oh Nuh, no one is going to accept a message besides those who've already accepted the message. No more people. How? Have you ever thought of what that verse means? It means that you and I have a quota of reminders from Allah, after which there will be no more reminders. After which the punishment comes. So your quota might be 500 reminders. Mine might be 200 reminders, 300, 1000, whatever. I don't know the figure. Allah knows there will be so many messages. One will come to you via the radio, the other one via the internet, the other one on an iPod, the other one through an application, the other one on the television, the other one when you are sitting and listening to the tadhkira or the chirama at the masjid, and you have a message directed to you. People feel this is directed to me. No, it's not. It's Allah directing it to you, not the speaker. That's Islam. You will hear a talk of someone who doesn't know you online. And it's as though they are speaking to you, not because they knew you, because Allah chose them to say something that would affect you. That's what it is. That was a message. And guess what? It's ticked off. The angels know. Message, get to them, got to them. He heard it, heard it. What did he do? Wait. He still hasn't changed. She still hasn't changed. Tick again. Okay, now we send you a CD. By mistake, you're hearing it because you caught a lift with someone. It's not a mistake. It was planned by Allah. So what is it? It's ticked off. The angels know. Did he hear it? He heard it, ticked off. Gone. Then what happens? You have another one and another one. Oh, you came for Jum'ah and for some reason the masjid you always go to, something happened, too much traffic, and you had to go to another masjid, and the message was powerful. That was for you. You had to go from there to here. You don't know Allah's plan. He planned it in a way that you just arrived there without even knowing. Subhanallah. And when you got there, message, the angels, did he hear it? Heard it, tick off. What number is that? 499. How many left? One. Has he changed? No, he hasn't. One more left. And suddenly you come to the straight path convention. MashaAllah. What happened? Did he hear it? Did they hear it? We heard it. Did you hear it?
Yes.
Allahu Akbar. Tick. Gone. Allahu Akbar. Are you going to change? Allah. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala accept us. Like I told you, even if it's 1 millimeter, we have succeeded. Even if it is 1 millimeter. But don't let shaitan make you stop at that millimeter. Continue. A millimeter must become an inch. I give you an example of a businessman or anyone who's working. If your salary remains at 500 ringgits a month, you're going to quit the job within 1 month, 2 months. You might not even want the job in the first place. Take the salary, don't worry. It's the experience you are getting at this stage. But you want an increment, you want promotion. If they stop promoting you and for 20 years you're sitting at the same spot and you're not happy with the conditions, even if you are happy, you want promotion, you want promotion. Why? It's the nature of man. He doesn't want to sit in one spot. You have a business, you opened a little place that sells vegetables on the side of the road and it starts flourishing. You've got to start making bigger orders. You hire a stall. Now you have a stall and it starts flourishing. You want to hire a little place. Every month you pay the rental and now it's a shop. It's a corner shop. The corner shop starts flourishing. What happens? You open another corner shop. Where? In Penang. Why? I've got a branch in KL. I need one there. And then you open one elsewhere. And before you know it, you've got 40, 50 branches. What's going to happen with all the money? You're never going to use it. That's how much money you've got. You're never going to use it. Start thinking of the bigger picture. Allah's now given me. I went from one stage to another. What about my worldly? What about my akhirah? The non-worldly life, the hereafter. What about that? What about my eternal life? I tell you, if we had to treat Jannah the same way we treated this world, in the case of a lot of us, we would achieve Jannah easier than we think. Why? Who wants a house in Jannah? Put up your hand. May Allah grant you the house through His mercy. I tell you, if you want a house in Jannah, you have to buy it. It doesn't just come free. Ala inna sil'ata Allahi ghaliya. The hadith says the commodity of Allah is not cheap. It's actually valuable, very expensive. How do I pay for it? Well, those of us who have been caught in riba, in interest, usually, and we've taken mortgages and we know how the loans work. They've enslaved us for 20 years and we think we're going to have the house. We're going to have the house. We're going to have the house. 18 years down the line, the bank repossesses the place. You heard that? 18 years down the line, repossessed. What happened? Oh no, I paid 18 years. Gone, it's gone. Why? Because I didn't pay for 2-3 months. Those are payments made for a little house in this world that you probably, by the time you end up paying, you'll only live there for 3-4 more years because you're already 80. It's possible. But when it comes to Jannah, every salah is a payment of $1 million. I get up for Fajr, 1 million. Every day I must pay. You miss one or two, repossession. Watch out. Be careful. You are sent a warning first to say, hey, you missed Salatul Fajr. So you feel guilty. Why? Because hey, I don't normally miss it. But you miss it once, twice, thrice, you stop feeling guilty. Subhanallah. And then what happens? You get another warning. You start getting sick and ill. Oh, what's happening? Allah is saying, turn to me. And then you say, no, I'll go to the doctor. I've got money. I can fly to America and I'll have the top doctors. MashaAllah, may Allah grant you cure and me as well. May Allah grant all those who are sick and ill shifa. Say ameen. But at the same time, you fly out and the doctor say, we cannot do anything for you. At that stage, you have no option but to soften up to Allah. So when Allah tests you with hard, difficult situations, it is to soften you to Him. To soften you to Allah. You begin to cry for the first time in your life, as manly as you are. For whom? Quietly. No one's watching me. Between me and Allah. And Allah loves that condition so much. Because now you will start repenting. Not only Salatul Fajr, but guess what came into the picture? Take a guess. Tahajjud. You said it. We know. How did tahajjud come? I never read tahajjud before, but I had a massive problem, people will say, and that's what made me start. And when I started tahajjud, the sweetness I got from it was so valuable that even when my problem was done, I kept it up. That's the winner. A loser is the one who, oh Allah, I promise you, I'll never do that. I promise you, I'm going to read my salah. And as soon as mashallah, your problem is solved, everything happened. Hey, where are you? You're no longer in the masjid. Why? Problem solved. So Allah says, wait, we tap in you again. We're tapping you again. And then you say, but Allah, why are you testing me again? You already tested me once. Hang on. When we tested you once, you came back to us. But when we gave you back what you wanted, you drifted away from us. So we love you so much, we want to keep you close to us. Because we know it's good even if you die in this condition, but you are close to us, you will earn paradise. This is why they say, when a sick person sees the reward that Allah has kept for them on that day, they will say, oh Allah, why didn't you keep me sick my entire life? Look at how much this reward is. Allahu Akbar. When a person going through trial, tribulation, calamity bears sabr for the sake of Allah, Allah says, إِنَّمَا يُوَفَّى الصَّابِرُونَ أَجْرَهُمْ بغير حساب. Indeed, we will recompense the one who bore patience, who was forbearant, who restrained himself for the sake of Allah with a reward that is unlimited. Imagine unlimited reward. Allah is saying, for you, unlimited. Why? Because you bore a lot of patience while you were on earth. Isn't that good news for me and for you? We all go through challenges. The sisters out there, many are suffering in silence, either in the homes as a mother, as a wife, as a daughter, whatever it is, as an aunt, as an in-law, anything. And the brothers, many of them are going through challenges, some of them financial, some of them health matters. May Allah grant us all ease in whatever difficulties we may be having in our peculiar lives. But that's Allah. When you bear sabr, He knows, He's watching. He heard your prayer. Don't worry. Repeat it and repeat it again, because Allah loves repetition. Remember that. Allah loves you to repeat. Do you know why? Because it keeps you soft. When Allah delays for something you want to happen, do you know what? It's because He wants to keep you as close as possible to Him. You're not crying hard enough. A relative of mine used to say, you're not making a hard enough dua. Make it big, make it hard. Meaning hard, meaning not as in difficult, but hard meaning it must be solid. Solid dua, oh Allah. You know, when I was young, this was always something very, very funny. We used to enter the masjid as little boys, and we used to see uncles in the front sitting, you know, mashallah. And they used to sit, some of them dedicated, some of them were all chairman. You know, everyone wants to be a chairman. And when I was young, I used to think, they say, he's the chairman. And I used to see him sitting on the chair. And I thought, okay, maybe that. Then I said, but dad, aren't all these other ones chairman as well? They're all sitting on the chairs. No, those are just people who are perhaps not able to stand. Oh, then we understood. Otherwise, I used to call them chairmen. So we enter the masjid, we see all the chairmans, mashallah. And at the same time, we're sitting at the back and we see them making dua. Now, you know, just before Maghrib, sometimes raise their hands and making dua to Allah. Then you see someone, oh Allah, grant me. Oh Allah, help me. And you say, wow, this man is crying. And look at his hands, he's asking Allah. And suddenly in the one corner, you say, oh Allah, help me. And say, hey, hey, this man has a big problem. Can you see how he's calling Allah? Yeah, Allah, Allah. But to be honest, that's his way of calling out to Allah. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam raised his hand so high that you could see the whiteness of his subhanallah. Subhanallah. You could see the whiteness close to his armpit. That's how high he raised his hands. What about us? We call out to Allah. Do we really call out? Or is it just in passing? Everything's smooth for us. My brothers and sisters, prepare for the day when you're going to leave this world. Prepare for that day. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will bless you. Just be ready for it. If I were to ask you, who wants Jannah? Everyone will say, I want Jannah. And if I were to ask you, who wants to die? No one wants to die. I've done it in the past. Well, how are you going to get to Jannah if you don't die? That's a beautiful question. So now you're left with only one option. Oh Allah, take us away in a condition that you are pleased with us. Oh Allah, take us away in a condition that you are pleased with us. Have mercy on us, oh Allah. Grant us goodness, oh Allah. Grant us Jannah, oh Allah. Not just us, but even our offspring. I said it earlier today, brothers and sisters, pass the torch that you have to the next generation. I tell you why. The deen is being fought from all angles. In the sense, we have internal problems and external problems. If you don't convey that message to your own children, you trust other people to do that, they won't. They might deviate your child. You need to be so close to your own family members and those who are in your circle, and try and broaden the circle to reach out with that goodness to maximum number of people. Perhaps Allah will give you paradise through the number of lives that you have touched rather than your own deeds. May Allah grant that to us. Wa sallallahu wa sallama wa baraka ala nabina Muhammad. Subhanallah bihamdihi. Subhanakallahumma bihamdik. Nashhadu an la ilaha illa anta nastaghfiruka wa natubu ilayk.